Hello friends, welcome once again to The Abundant Life. My topic for today, can widowed persons, widows and widowers experience the abundant life? Well, let me share with you my experience at various funerals, month's mind masses, anniversary masses. What do I see and hear? Crying, wailing, bitterly cursing, fainting. People are inconsolable. I even heard of a woman who tried jumping into the grave of her husband. Well, friends, I have been widowed for 35 years. And perhaps over the years, I have become tougher. But it does not imply that I am insensitive to those who are newly widowed when I ask, can the widowed experience abundant life? Well, from my experience, the answer is an emphatic yes, we can experience the abundant life. But it may take time and there will be ups and downs. In fact, if I am alive today and living the abundant life today, it is entirely due to the Lord's unconditional love and mercy towards me. Anyway, the abundant life depends upon what kind of abundant life one is talking about. Whether the abundant life offered by Jesus or the abundant life offered by the world. The worldly abundant life is linked with hedonistic lifestyles. You drown yourself in eating, drinking, making merry, hoping to drown your grief. This may satisfy you for a while, but ultimately leaves you empty, and in the long run, you feel bad about your very life. I came across the four P's that the world offers. Pornography, potation, implying alcohol, pot, implying drugs like cannabis, and of course, prostitutes and the promiscuity that they encourage. And many of us absurdly fall into these traps which the devil and the world lays out for the vulnerable. But mind you, the relief is there, but it is temporary. And the craving for more keeps on increasing. They are mere palliatives. They do not mitigate or reduce the pain or intensity of one's grief. Instead, it causes pain to others in the family. Strangely, though temporary in nature, one can get hooked and stuck like the fly in the spider's web, this web which the devil lays out before us. For a while, I myself tried to drown in the allurements and distractions of the world and the flesh. It was a sort of foolish defiance of God. I can manage on my own. I do not need you. But it did not work. And I thank God that it did not work. I thank God for bringing me to my knees and out of my foolishness. Today, I can sincerely say, Lord, I know that you have brought good out of everything bad that happened to me in my life. Well, friends, we have seen how the abundant life can be offered by the world, which is temporary. But Jesus, on the other hand, offers us the abundant life that is almost permanent in nature, as we read in John 10, verse 10. I came that you may have life and have it in abundance. And if this life is not permanent, Jesus is not to blame. We are to blame. So, friends, this is a gift that Jesus gives us, and we must accept, cherish, nurture, and share it with others. Now, if we rearrange the first alphabet of each of those words above, you will get A-C-N-S, and it turns into S-C-A-N, scan. Scan our lives and scan the things around so that you avoid pitfalls. That is what my talk for today is about. Scan our behavior and see how we can have the abundant life. So let's begin with the first, accept. Accept the abundant life of Jesus wholeheartedly, and not what I want to pick and choose or what suits me. So, if the Lord wants me to accept even the death of my spouse, I should wholeheartedly accept it. And what are the benefits? When we accept, God will bring good out of it. As you all know, God writes straight on crooked lines. He will write straight on the crooked lines of our lives. I am reminded of the marriage vows we take. I accept you for better or for worse, in sickness or in health, in riches or in poverty, etc. Similarly, we should accept God's will 100%. Thy will be done. As we read in Luke chapter 11, verse 38, let it be done with me according to thy word. That's what Mother Mary said. Let us put that into our lives as well. I put this in practice. I had a nice bank job in Bombay. And when my wife fell sick, I left that bank job to fulfill my marriage vows, to be with my wife in her sickness, as I was prepared to be with her in her good health. And I have had no regrets for having left my bank jobs. Let's look at the next word, cherish, to love. Before this, I said the Angelus thousands of times maybe. Especially that line comes to my mind, be it done unto me according to thy word. But now, today, I have come to cherish the meaning of this line and its importance in my life. Let me briefly share with you my story when the doctor pronounced my wife as dead. I had trusted God and I knew that He would heal her, but God had other plans. And I looked up to heaven and I said, Lord, you have let me down. But the next moment I said, Thy will be done. In fact, such utterances began to fill my life as, help me, Lord. I need thee, Lord. You alone can satisfy me. Help my weakness, my sin. Jesus, I trust in you. I surrender, Lord, to you. And that's a hymn I even composed in the depths of my pain and grief. Well, hymns may be sung silently or aloud. Among my favorites, and there are many, I have chosen two. I need thee every hour. Also, be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. There are songs in general with nice lyrics, uplifting lyrics, and they can be a great help. For example, you raise me up. I love to listen to the words. Let's look at the next word, nurture, which means to sustain, to feed, to care for. So, how does one nurture the abundant life which Jesus offers? Well, three things come to mind. Prayer, personal prayer, at least 10 minutes in the morning before you begin your day, and family prayer, perhaps the rosary together. Then again, adoration, if possible, before the Blessed Sacrament, whenever you can make it. And thirdly, the sacraments, especially the sacrament of confession and the Eucharist daily if possible. I find tremendous help in attending Mass daily. Then again, reading and praying with the Bible and other religious-based books are a great help when tempted to indulge in pornographic magazines or TV serials with sexual connotations. Pick up your Bible, it'll give you strength. Also, buy spiritual books, and when your birthday comes around, tell your friends, give me good spiritual books, forget about anything else. Friends, get involved in church activities. For example, I was a member of the parish council for 3 terms. I was a member of a prayer group and even became its leader. Join such groups and it will help you. I remember when my wife was in the female ward in hospital, the prayer group leader came to my help. He invited ladies from the group to spend 1 night each with my hospital, with my wife in the hospital, because I, as a man, was not allowed in the female ward. Friends, nurture yourselves and others by starting support groups. I started what was called GROWERS, G-R-O-W, Goa Regional Organization of the Widowed. Unfortunately, we could not continue because I was the only man and there were many roses around me. But it has helped where I have even started such a group in my own parish. Some things we try to do, visit the recently bereaved, pray with them. It helps those persons who need your comfort. Let's remember, no man is an island. We need others. But have a spiritually strong friend as your mentor, preferably a priest as your regular counselor, confessor, or spiritual guide. I have been fortunate in having such a spiritual father since 1982. He was a great help during my wife's illness and after that, even up to today. Let's look at the next word, share. You heard this. Sorrows shared become sorrows halved. Who better than the Lord Jesus and His Mother Mary to share your burdens with? I have found great consolation in Jesus and Mary. But human beings that we are, we also need to share with other flesh and blood human beings. I owe a tremendous debt of gratitude to my family, my friends, my neighbors, my colleagues. I couldn't have carried on without their help. What does one share? Well, difficulties, successes, problems, both personal and interpersonal. I know there were times when I needed to talk even about certain problems I was having in my own home. And that is where I got this strength from my spiritual father. And then, as one gets on in years and gets closer to the Lord, it is useful to share in the form of testimonies in magazines and at prayer meetings. Well, I'm talking to you just now. It's my testimony. I'm using TV as my medium. Friends, we thus see that the abundant life can be assisted by others. But there comes a time when we have to learn to be self-reliant and self-generating, which means aim to be independent, especially as you advance in age. Do not make crutches of your children and others. They have their own problems. Let's learn to be independent. Genesis chapter 19 verse 26 says, Lot's wife looked behind and turned into a pillar of salt. We too often look behind and feel guilty, especially if we have rejoiced at the death of an alcoholic husband or a bossy mother-in-law and so on. Well, the solution, we need to confess this. On the other hand, We may look ahead and get petrified at the challenges that lie ahead. Petrified, as you know, is one form of turning into stone, or, humanly speaking, become rigid. Therefore, let's trust the Lord. Let's praise and thank God for the past as well as for what lies ahead. I like a quote attributed to Dag Hammarskjöld, the UN Secretary General, who sadly passed away in an air crash. What was it he said? "For all that has been, thanks. And for all that is to come, yes." We too need to say thanks for the past, yes to the future. Another quote I like is, "Lord, help me remember that nothing shall happen to me today that you and I together cannot handle." In John chapter 15, verses 1 and following, we read about the vine and the branches. Well, those who find it difficult to accept God's will very easily turn to other philosophies and gods with disastrous consequences. Therefore, like the branch, let us cling to the Lord, the vine, and we will be courageous and successful in life. If you are brave enough to say goodbye, I read, life will reward you with a new hello. Close the door to the past and open the door to the future. When our spouses passed away, we were strong enough to say goodbye. Let us pray for strength to say hello to the future. To sum up then, here are some points we could try out, either individually or as a group of the bereaved. Let us have the practice of a weekly or monthly hour of adoration. Tremendous strength is there in adoration before the Blessed Sacrament. Then, do not discourage crying unless it is excessive. On the other hand, encourage crying in those like widowers who think it is not manly to show your tears. Friends, let us cry when we need to, but let us cry in secret in the company of Mother Mary, who kept all these things in her heart, as we read in Luke chapter 2, verse 51. Avoid cutting yourself off totally from socializing. For instance, attending marriage parties, birthday parties, and so on. You could end up becoming a grumpy old recluse. So socialize when possible. Pray with quotes that strike you in your reading. For example, I read this and I think it's from the Daily Flash. It says, "Lord, make me aware of my need to seek your primacy in all things." What a beautiful quote. Do not sit at home and mope. Just get out. It will help you cope. You will find tremendous physical and spiritual help. We know how Veronica wiped the face of Jesus. We are invited to become Veronicas, wiping the tears of the bereaved. For example, at least once in a way, let us visit an orphanage, or more often, a home for the aged, where they want people to talk to. They crave attention. Let's help them. Men, seek help in developing cooking skills. I've heard of men who can't even make a cup of tea. What about women? Women seek help in learning banking skills. I know of persons, when their husbands died, they didn't know how to operate their bank accounts. Let's read and meditate upon 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7, pertaining to St. Paul's thorn in the flesh. All of us have a thorn in the flesh, vis-a-vis, for instance, our need to overcome our self-righteous pride, our ego, our sin. Let's turn to the Lord and seek His strength. Rick Warren, an American, has this valuable suggestion. He says, in happy moments, praise God. In difficult moments, seek God. In quiet moments, worship God. And in painful moments, trust God. What a beautiful thing, isn't it? Remember Isaiah chapter 49, verse 16, which says, a mother may forget the baby, but God will not forget us. Why? Because we are carved, we are engraved on the palm of the Father's hand. So, we need to remember that. And when we feel low or depressed, just FIFA. Am I gone crazy? Yes, just FIFA, which means fall into the Father's arms. F for fall, I for into, F again Father's, and A for arms. Do it often. My dear friends, imagine yourselves falling gently into the Father's arms. He will carry you forward. Trust Him. You will find great blessings when you FIFA. So once again, just FIFA. God bless you.